Hey guys, Derek here from Back to Reality. And in this video, I'd like to answer some of your most frequently asked questions about the Ruth Stout method and about growing no-dig vegetables under mulch. But if you haven't seen our previous videos on this topic, please do check out the links in the description because much of what I'm about to discuss probably won't make as much sense otherwise. However, before we dive in, I'd also like to give a really quick but pretty important disclaimer. This will be obvious to those of you who've been following our journey from the beginning, but for those who are new to the channel, please note that Paula and I are not gardening experts. We're well-researched, we're enthusiastic, and we love to experiment with natural techniques, but we're also still just learning as we go. So please keep that in mind if ever you decide to follow our lead or replicate our results. Because as with anything in life, your results may vary, and it's always important to do your own research as well. Okay, now with that out of the way, let's get started. I think the best question to address first is where we're located, because our local growing conditions are likely quite a bit different than many of yours. You see, we're located in eastern Ontario, Canada, meaning that our season tends to be on the shorter side and our climate tends to be cooler and wetter than many other parts of the world. Now, we've previously posted an entire video all about our annual rainfall, our hardiness zone, and anything else we could think of that might come in handy when trying to determine if our experiments would make sense in your garden. So again, I've placed a link to that video in the description and encourage you to check it out. The next question is all about the type of mulch we use, because most of our experimentation has been with old spoiled hay, but many of you have asked if we actually mean straw. So just in case there are any regional differences in the definitions, I'll first quickly clarify exactly what we're talking about. Around here, hay is harvested by cutting a grassy field, leaving it to dry, and then forming it into bales, and it's primarily used to feed farm animals. On the other hand, straw is made up of the bare, dried stalks left over after harvesting grain crops, and is typically used as animal bedding. So hay is essentially grass, alfalfa, clover, and anything else that grows naturally in the field. It's packed with lots of nutrition, and it's easily chewed and digested when eaten by animals. Whereas straw is much more woody and fibrous, making it difficult to eat and far less nutrient-rich. So unlike hay, straw is really just a byproduct. It's a necessary waste material that has luckily found a valuable use as bedding. So that's the definitions out of the way, but the follow-up question is usually, okay, but which one makes for a better mulch? And honestly, from our own personal experiences, I'm not actually sure. Because so far between the two, we've only ever used hay. Because unlike straw, hay tends to be readily available in our area. And it also happened to be the preferred mulching material of Ruth Stout, so it's what we've used the most. But from what we've read, there are some pros and cons to each. For example, since hay contains more nutrients and breaks down much quicker, it's believed to do a better job at enriching your soil over time. It also tends to tangle up pretty quickly, which stops it from blowing away in the wind. But on the other hand, hay can also contain seeds, which can germinate in your garden. More on that in a moment. And because straw stays loose and fluffy, it can be easier to work with, but it's also more susceptible to wind. So if you're just looking to suppress weeds and retain moisture, then straw's a great option. But if your goal is to also improve your soil fertility, then hay would probably be the better choice. But at the end of the day, I believe that any mulch is better than no mulch. So it's best to just use whatever you have access to, be that hay, straw, lawn clippings, fallen leaves, wood chips, etc. And once again, I've included a link to another video all about the different types of mulch we've used and where we got them for free. So please check that out if you're interested. Oh, and another related question is, what exactly do we mean by spoiled hay? Well, as I mentioned, hay is used for animal feed, which means that freshness is very important. So if it sits around for too long, or even worse, if it gets wet, it's no longer useful for that intended purpose. And at that point, many farmers would just haul it off and let it rot. But luckily, our garden is quite happy to receive mulch that's already partially broken down, so old, moldy hay is perfect. And since it's basically just garbage at that point, some farmers will happily give it away just to get rid of it. But again, fresh hay works great too, so don't stress if you can't find any of the spoiled stuff. Plus, I should also note that very moldy hay, especially if it's also very dry at the time, can release spores into the air when it's pulled apart. It looks like a fine dust cloud, and this can be pretty harmful if inhaled. You see, over a prolonged period of time, it can lead to a condition called farmer's lung. And though it's most often associated with hay, it can technically occur with any crop, like straw, for example. So if you're working with mulch and notice any mold or dust clouds, it's probably a good idea to wet it first, because that helps to prevent the dust from rising up into the air. Or better yet, consider wearing a face mask of some sort. This is actually something that Paula and I have recently decided to incorporate into our mulching practice, because it can be a serious issue and it's probably time we treat it as such. Okay, now let's talk about weeds. Because one of the main benefits of covering your garden with a thick layer of mulch is that it suppresses weed growth. But we often get asked whether or not it actually eliminates all weeding. And the quick answer to that question is no. But in our experience, it does get pretty close. So mulch does two things that help prevent weeds. First, it forms a protective cover that prevents any new seeds that happen to land in your garden from reaching the soil. Plus, it also smothers out any existing weeds that were already present. However, some weeds are more determined than others and can push their way through even a foot or more of mulch. And some just get lucky and happen to find a thin spot that they can sneak through. So in both cases, some pulling will still be required. But the great thing is that rather than having to remove it from the garden entirely, the weed can instead just be dropped right where it grew. It then becomes even more mulch and will eventually return its nutrients back to your soil. But either way, there is still some weeding. Just far less. And the only major exception in our garden has been certain types of grasses that propagate through rhizomes, but we'll be covering that in detail in an upcoming video, so stay tuned. But a moment ago I mentioned weed seeds that come in the hay, and we often get asked about those as well. But honestly, they just haven't been a problem for us. We've had some seeds that germinate on the surface, but without access to the soil underneath, they've always quickly died before becoming a problem. However, we have heard from many others who've said that their entire garden became a mini hayfield, so it's obviously possible. But I think the main problem with hayseeds comes from either not adding a thick enough layer or from tilling the mulch into the garden at the end of the season. Because in that case, the seeds do come into contact with the soil and can easily germinate and become established. However, if you follow a no-till approach and just continue to add more mulch year after year, then it seems to be far less of an issue. But that said, if you're at all concerned about the seeds, then I'd just play it safe and use a different kind of mulch instead. Or at least use hay in a smaller section first to see how it works out. Remember, this is supposed to make gardening easier, so the last thing we want to do is add stress to your life. Oh, and speaking about making things easier, the next question we get all the time is about watering. How much, how often, etc. Because we've mentioned in previous videos that we've gone an entire season without watering our potatoes, for example. And that's because the other major benefit of deep mulch is that it holds in moisture and prevents evaporation. So we've found that for the most part, simply relying on rainfall has been sufficient, even during month-long droughts. However, as I mentioned in the beginning, our local conditions are likely different from yours. So it's best to assume that, much like weeding, you will still have to water, just much less. So deep mulch often promises to require less of some things, but one thing that many people are concerned they might end up with more of is unwanted visitors, like mice, voles, slugs, and earwigs. But again, so far in our experience, this hasn't been a problem. We do have each of those animals in our garden, but never enough to be a real issue. However, a few of you have commented about this, so it's obviously a thing. For example, a number of you have said that mice and voles tunneled under your mulch and nibbled away at your potatoes without even being detected. And others have said that they were overrun with slugs. But from what we understand, this can be caused by environmental factors as well, like an unusually mild winter or an overly wet spring. So it's possible that some have just had really unfortunate timing. And also possible that we've just been extremely lucky so far. Not to mention that our tolerance for animals in the garden may be a little higher than most. But in any case, please do take those risks into consideration as well. And speaking about potatoes, many of you have also asked if the spuds grown under hay taste any different, or if they're any less nutritious having not been grown in soil. And I think the reason for those types of questions is actually due to a slight misunderstanding of exactly how this method works. Because though the tubers are buried under mulch, they're also still in contact with the soil below. And keep in mind that though we often think of potatoes as a root crop, the actual tubers are really just storage organs and are technically part of the stems. Whereas it's the true roots that do all the collecting of nutrients, and they still live under the soil, whether mulched or not. So these potatoes taste the same, look the same, and though we've never had them analyzed, I can only assume that they're just as nutritious too. But it's not just about the spuds. Because many of you have seen our videos about potatoes and garlic, and then wondered if other veggies can be grown this way as well. And the answer to that question is a resounding yes. Because though we've experimented with a number of different techniques over the past few years, all of them have included some form of mulching as the final step. And though some have been more successful than others, from what we can tell, the mulch has always been a benefit. Well, except for our strawberries, but that was less about the mulch around the plants and more about the fact that we actually covered the tops of the crowns, something that we've since discovered is a strawberry planting no-no. Plus, I'm still pretty sure that the crowns may have actually been duds from the start, but I digress. Now, we're currently in the process of making a short video about how to plant various types of veggies in a mulched garden, but the basic idea is just push the mulch aside and then plant like normal. If it's a seedling, you can push the mulch back around the stem, and if it's seeds, then just leave the soil exposed until they begin to grow. So far with this method, we've successfully grown potatoes, garlic, onions, carrots, tomatoes, lettuce, cabbage, turnips, beets, cucumbers, zucchini, asparagus, corn, winter squash, eggplant, and many, many more. And all of them grew like normal, but needed less watering and less weeding as a result. And finally, this one is less of a frequently asked question and more like a frequently stated warning. In fact, because a number of you have brought it up, we've now begun mentioning it in any video that seems relevant, and I think it's best that we continue to. Because unfortunately, while pretty much any natural plant-based mulch will work, depending on where you live, it's getting harder to find. Not the mulch, but the natural. You see, for example, hay is now often sprayed with pesticides and preservatives, and wood chips are often dyed. So if you stumble upon a good supply, it's really important that you ask questions and do some research before using it. Because the last thing you want to do when trying to emulate nature is accidentally introduce a bunch of detrimental chemicals into your garden. So please keep that in mind too. But that's all the questions we were hoping to address in this video. However, if there's anything we've missed, please let us know in the comments. And if this is something that you guys found helpful, then we'll do our best to make more of these question and answer style videos in the future. But in the meantime, thanks for watching. And we'll see you soon.